deadlock. I think that today I'm going to end the class 5 to 10 minutes earlier due to the engineering 400 preparation. As you know, I'm organizing the engineering 400, even though you already passed the engineering 400. Is a good opportunity to meet the speaker, invited speaker. Most of them are related to engineering or the science area. So also, most of them are from the industry or the academia, even though industry related to the research part. So it will be a good opportunity. As I mentioned many times before, I don't know this class. So for example, if you are thinking about the startup company after graduation or right now, sometimes you are wonder, I do not have any idea or the basic skill or something. So take a look at the current research paper. Usually the industry is 4 to 5 years later than the academia. So which means if the academia published the paper regarding to the, for example, right now the hot issue is the AI, but the industry is usually slightly later than that. It takes time because they need to consider the commercialization, and so then it will take a time. But academia usually faster than the industry, so it can direct the future of the technology and so on. So when you attend such a conference, invited talk, so you will get some insight or idea of such a thing. Or if you are interested in the higher degree, like the PhD as in the research area, also it's a good opportunity. So I strongly suggest to you guys that if you have, probably you do not have any class during that time, because in engineering, school of engineering, we open the Thursday 4:30 to the 6 o'clock. To give the opportunity for all the students to attend the engineering curriculum series. So today we are going to invite Professor Abdul Shakur regarding to the Internet of Things, the IoT. Then the next speaker will be March 23rd after spring break. So Professor Lofaro from the George Mason University, he is expertise on the humanoid robot. So there are many different types of robots, like the industry, only arm, the big things. Some of them doesn't look like the robot, but they are still the robot. But the Professor Pearl is working on the human-like, the humanoid robot. So there are the competition, like we pretend the natural disaster or something disaster. So whether the robot can solve the problem, like to open the door or save the life and so on, and working the uneven the area, something like that. His team won one of the DARPA, such a DARPA sponsored such a robot competition, so it will be very interesting. And there are many more on April, so please voluntarily join the Engineering 400 curriculum series. This semester, we are using the Dynahall 107. It's not that far, so it was the ABC building, but this time the Dynahall. Okay, so because of that, I'm going to end the lecture a little bit earlier than today. Exercise lab will be the March 9th, the next week, the Thursday. So please bring your laptop for the exercise lab. At that time, we will cover any missing part of the exercise lab. And the midterm will be March 23rd after spring break. It's Thursday in the classroom. I will give the more information about the midterm. Is it Tuesday? 23rd. It's a Thursday. I change it. If we don't agree, if you want to, we can do the 21st. Tuesday, do you want?
No.
There's no difference. But I have another exam morning, so I'd like to keep all the exam in one day. And also, I have another guest speaker, so I directly flexible. Anyway, we will have exam 23rd. So I will give the more information about the exam. But anyway, the coverage will be chapter 1 through 6, not 7. If you want, I can include the 7.
No.
No? No difference. But so chapter 1 through 6. And I don't finish the make the question yet, but roughly 40% of the question will be multiple choices. The other 60% will be open-ended. Or sometimes a little bit more, the multiple choices, 45%, or the no more than the half, so multiple choices. So then the, among the multiple choices, maybe 30% or 40% of the multiple choices is around the 20% total. Less than 20% will be the quiz that you have done in the classroom, pop-up quiz. And the other will be the new question and the open-ended. I will give the more information about the exam later. Okay, that is the midterm exam. And you need to work on the project. Correct the due date, but you need to keep the due date of the multi-level feedback loop. So today we are going to talk about the deadlock. Okay, so this is the figure that I introduced the last time. This is an example of the deadlock. So the, for your reminder, deadlock will happen a lot. Not only the operating system, but also the any your application program, and also in our real life. This is an example of the real life, the deadlock situation. So deadlock usually happens. When does the deadlock happen? When you have something, okay? And also, there might be another one who is holding something. But I want that, right? Held by the another, your friend, right? And also, your friend asks the mine, right? So keep waiting, waiting each other. So this the situation explained all the details of the deadlock, which are the same situation as the deadlock in operating system. So today we are going to formally define what is the deadlock and what is the requirement, and we need to solve the problem. So how to resolve the deadlock problem in terms of the algorithm, okay, the, from the operating system perspective. Okay, so this first, to consider, I mentioned that there are two students and they have the item each other and holding. So in operating system, who will be the person? What will be the person? It's a process, right? So we, the process that we have, talked about a lot, the process management, the process. The process is kind of a consumer, process is kind of the producer, processor, process is the reader, writer, is the everything. So process is the, we have the, how many processes? Multiple processes. When we have only one process, there might be no problem. Single process operating system, there might be no problem on the synchronization, there might be no problem on the deadlock. However, when we have multiple processes, then it may cause the problem. So when we have the multiple the processes, then we have resources, item, okay? So there are something. So that is a resource. What types of resources? Anything in the operating system, such as the CPU, we talk about a lot the CPU, memory, and storage. So these are the hardware. Not only hardware, we have the software level, algorithm, or data structure, okay? Like the shared memory and the variable, okay? Variable that you define in the memory or the anything. And also, the operating system level, it's a software, but operating system level, data structure like the stack or the something in semaphore and the everything are considered as the resources. So physical resource, logical resource, anything. Or connection, like the, when you establish the link. So that will be the also resources. So these are the resources that we are considering. This is the keep top of the right side. I don't know why. So anyway, so that those are the resources that we are going to consider. And the, for example, these are the example when we have the two hard disk drive, the one process is holding the using, okay, using the disk one, and another process is using the disk two. Then process one is asking the disk two. At the same time, process two is asking the disk one. That's the deadlock forever. So to simplify. For example, when we have the process 1 and process 2, this one is using the disk 1, and this one is using disk 2, and then request. So, for your reminder, when the process uses the resource, how the process can use the computer resource? You need to just get this one? No, because we need to always request. For example, how can you open the file? How can you use the data? How can you read the data from the file? First, always you need to open the file. For example, in C program, you can use the fopen, the system library. So open, then use it, and that's it. Close. Always you close, okay? For example, in case of memory, MLOC. Okay, memory allocation. And use the memory and deallocation. Okay? Always, whenever you use any types of resource, request and use and close return. Because we are using the limited resource and the shareable resource always is the kind of etiquette to return the all the resource that you used. Okay? So in from the this point of view, whenever this one is being used, this one is being used, then request, then is keep waiting. So this is the deadlock situation. So I actually skip the deadlock situation in the synchronization problem. In the synchronization problem, we can use the semaphore, right? One of the solutions is the semaphore. We can use the semaphore as the lock, okay? So special case of the semaphore is the mutex lock. Mutex is a 0 or 1. In general, semaphore is the is an integer list. But if we specify the 0 or 1, so which means it can be used for the lock, then how can we access the semaphore? Only two operations, wait and signal. So wait is kind of getting the lock, acquire the lock. So it's kind of the request to access the critical section. Okay, so wait. And another one is wait, the process, wait the queue. Then it's granted. Then try to wait the queue and try to wait the P requested. This is also deadlock situation. It happens a lot. So if you are using the, for example, in your program sometimes, you encounter such a problem like in your program. So you'd like to open the file, okay? Or you'd like to create the directory or folder. Then sometimes it works, sometimes it's an operating system error. You cannot create it. Then at the time you can think about the synchronization problem or such a deadlock situation, whether this one is held by another and whether this one has the waiting each other. So many of the time, such a case you can use try, okay? The error, it's a try. Try and catch. You can use such a thing, then you can guarantee you can solve the problem in the application level. Okay, so that is a deadlock, and this is an example. So I'm not going to give the more details of the real life situation. This can be also the consider. This is the similar as the first case. So this is called actually circular lock. Okay. So for example, we can consider the section, intersection as the resource. And this is a process. This is a process. Process is occupying the, this process is taking the this section, but this section is occupied by the this process. And so on and so on. They are waiting each other. So deadlock is not only the problem of the two process cases. Multiple process cases, it happened like this one. This is a general case of the deadlock. We will define the, such a general case the formally later. So to do that, we are going to model the system, operating system, this one. So from now on, if we are using, if I'm saying the R means resource time. So there are n number of the resource time, what R1 through the Rm, that may include the CPU, memory, data structure, and semaphore, any the resource can be considered. Then, how many the CPU you may have? One or two, three. So you may have the multiple instances of the specific resource. At the time, we will use the W instances of I type of the resource. So it may be possible each resource has the multiple instances. So multiple CPU, multiple the data structure, multiple the mutex lock, and so on. Okay, then when we access the, always access the data, there are three, the step, request, and the request, and use, and release. So request sometimes can be implemented as open, allocate, it's the same thing. So we get the request, the resource, then use, and release. Then, there are four requirements to be a deadlock. So, for example, think about the this case. So in this case, how many are the, we can consider the section of the this one, section of the this one as the resource. Then, how current at certain time, how many process can take the resource? Only one. Okay? So in other words, we can, if we allow the shareable resource, there might be no problem. So I'm using the this one, but she's asking this, but if this one is shareable, there might be no problem to use that. However, if we allow only one process can use the, this device, if one car can pass the section, then that is called the mutual exclusion. So in case of a mutual exclusion, it may cause the deadlock situation. So first requirement of the deadlock is mutual exclusion. How many process? Only one process. Okay, then this car is greedy. So which means it's taking the current resource, the section of that. Then request the another section, which is held by another process, right? So for example, I'm holding the this one, using the this one, but then I'm asking to the other. Also, she's asking this when she's holding the item that I'm asking, which means always hold something and request the other. It's called the hold and wait, okay? Hold and wait. It's always greedy, so hold and wait. So second requirement of the deadlock is hold and wait. Always I have something and request the other, wait. So this one is the same thing, hold and wait. The first requirement, mutual exclusion. Second, hold and wait. Third is the really greedy, which means no preemptive, which means the CPU can be always stop and resume, like the context switch, which is the preemptive resource, okay? But in this case, if this car is never backed up, that is the greedy. So it's a non-preemptive. So non-preemptive caused such a deadlock problem. So third requirement of the deadlock is non-preemptive, okay? Then the last one is, for example, we have the three, the people, and I'm holding, she's holding, she's also holding item. I'm requesting her item, and she's requesting her item. She's requesting my item. which means?
Circularly.
It's a waiting circularly. So circular waiting. Okay? So it doesn't have to, even the two process cases, two person, it's a circular, right? But in case of one, the process is not circular. So when we have a multiple resource, even though that is the hold and wait, mutual exclusion, non-preemptive, but if that is not circular, in other words, what is the opposite of the circular? Serial. If that is a serializable, then that is not the deadlock. In this case, waiting this, is a circular way. So last requirement of the deadlock is circular way. So by reference, first, mutual exclusion. Only one process can access the resource. Second,
hold and wait.
So always hold and wait. If you do not hold anything, it doesn't cause the problem. Okay? If you just hold it but not requesting, it's not part of deadlock. So hold and wait. Third one, non-preemptive. Never be bad. Never be the generous. Always greedy. And circular way. So these four are considered the characteristic of the deadlock. Okay, then we can formalize such a circular way by using, from now on, we have been used the notation P. So we have the N number of P, and the P is waiting P1, P2, and Pn is waiting the P0, the item held by P0, circular way. So these are the deadlock characterization requirement of the deadlock. If we can find such a characteristic, then we can declare this is the deadlock. Okay, then, which one is the most the critical, the requirement in this case? Mutual exclusion? It's always the usually. It's shareable or non-shareable. It says many of them are mutual exclusion. The critical part is the circular weight, okay? Circular. When they weigh the circular, then that is the deadlock. This is frequently happen in general. But if their weighting is circular, we can say that is a deadlock. So to solve the problem, so we are going to use the resource allocation graph. It's called the RAG. So what is a graph?
Set of vertices and edges. Set of vertices and edges.
Mm-hmm.
Any other? So many of the my question can be answered as? It's a data structure. That's true. In your data structure class, so you probably learned about the deadlock, probably end of your textbook, right? So graph is also data structure used in the computer science, and not only just the computer science operating system, but the many of the hardware and algorithms, they are using the graph. So what is a graph? Graph is, what about the tree? Are they same, tree structure and graph structure?
No.
No, it's different. But in general, if you are learning the data structure, you probably learned node. Node is the basic item, okay? Record. Each node has the attribute. So that is a node, okay? Then, depending on how to organize the node, we have the stack, queue, linked list, and so on. And then we have tree structure. What is a tree? Tree is the different types of node. One is root node, internal node, and leaf node, terminal node. Then they have the specific relationship, parent and child relationship. Any node should have the parent node, except the root. All node has the children node, number of children node, except the terminal node. Then they always the one directional, top to bottom, root to the leaf, the relationship, which is called the relationship. So we have the node, number of node, and they have the parent and child relationship. That is the tree structure. So tree can be used for many of the computer science problems. Even it can be used for sorting the data. Do you remember that? Yes. How can you use the tree structure for sorting the data? So binary tree is the how many children? Maximum two. If you can make the binary tree, we can always the tree structure has the problem of how to travel. It's a travel the problem. So if we can access the tree left the node right L N R, then it will be sorted the data. So for example, so tree is very useful. Then what about the graph? Tree always has the top to bottom parent to children relationship. It's a one direction. It's a very specific direction. Okay, that's the constraint. But not always we have the such a relationship. Like the, my friend, is there any the master and slave? No, not such a the relationship. So we need more generalized the such a tree structure, which is the graph structure. So graph has a number of nodes. That is the same as a tree, but their relationship is not like the parent and children. It's just a relationship between two nodes, which is called edges. So graph has the two part. Graph has number of nodes. Edge is E. Number of nodes and number of edges. But this edge is the relationship V1 and V2. The two of them. This is a graph. So graph is used very, very useful for what? To find the relationship of each node. Think about your Facebook or any social media data. Okay? Then we have a number of friends, number of people, user. Then the main problem of the using the social media data is what? How many friends do you have? You want more and more friends, and because of that, sometimes you exaggerate your life, right? Then to make the friend. That is a key point. Not only the business perspective, but the user. Actually, the Facebook and the social media company, they use such a the kind of instinct of the people for the to expand. Then if they have the bigger and bigger the social network, then they can make the money by applying some business the marketing or whatever. So that is the social media network. Then the to represent the such a relationship, is it the better to use the tree? No, tree is always top to bottom in the direction, but I don't want to such a direction. So just the relationship between two user. Okay. So at that time we can use the graph. Similarly, so we'd like to adapt to such a the graph structure to characterize the deadlock situation. Deadlock include the resource and the processes. Then the it's kind of the relationship between the two user, two processes. I'm requesting and I'm the holding. I'm requested. So there are two types of the node in the resource allocation graph. One is the resource. It's called the R. Another one is the process. Process is the P. Okay? So in this case, we have just one type of node, but in resource allocation graph, to characterize our operating system, we have the two process. To represent R, the resource, we are going to use the square. Okay? Usually this is a graph. Right? The circle is the node, this is the edge, but here we are going to define two different types of node. One node is a resource, it's a square. Another node is a circle, it's for the processor. For example, R1, P1, it's a process one. This is a resource type one. Okay? At that time, if you have multiple instances, like I have the four CPU, then you can use the small square inside, which means we have a 1, 2, 3, 4. So W1, W2, W3, W4. So four instances of the this resource. So this is the node. So we have node, Then there are two types of edges. That is request. And another one is assign. For example, P1 is requesting the resource type 1. At the time, you can make the arrow. So P1 is request. Process to the resource. Requesting. So for example, P2 request resource type 2. Request. At that time, the end of arrow meet to the outer box. Because it's not assigned yet. It's just requesting. Then, if it is assigned, request is admit. Then, assign that from the resource to the process. So, this is called directed graph. The directed graph is undirected graph means there's no direction. It's just a relationship between you and me. But directed graph is like the Twitter. Twitter, you follow. Okay? If you follow me, then it's from my message to him. Right? But what about the friendship of the Facebook? Mutually agreed. Right? So which means there's no direction. You can request, but once accept, it is the no direction. Okay? Or bi-direction. It's actually bi-direction. So that is the same idea here. If assigned is from resource to process assigned. At that time, if you have multiple instances, it can start from the specific instance, like this one. For example, the resource type 1 is assigned to the process. So that means it's assigned edge. Assigned. So there are two types of the node, two types of edge. For the node, we have the process noted by the circle, and the resource noted by square. We have the two types of edge, request from process to resource, and assign resource to process. So this is the notation of the resource allocation graph. So we are going to use such a graph notation to formalize the deadlock problem. By the way, why we use the graph? Looks like more complicated. Anyway, eventually we are going to implement. So we'd like to know whether this is a deadlock or not. We'd like to solve that problem. How? Program. Okay, so we are doing the operating system. So we need to implement the algorithm to detect the deadlock, to solve the deadlock. To do that, our idea, such a detection the idea, and also such a characterization of the deadlock should be structured, data structure. For that data structure, we are going to use the graph, because the graph is the data structure that can represent very, very easily, not very, very, but easily, the relationship of the process and the resource, okay, node. So because of that, we are going to use the graph. And also, if we can use the graph structure, we can utilize any operation used in the graph, okay? Subgraph matching, subgraph searching, or something graph algorithm. We can be used. So that is the reason we adapt.